Check one, two. Good morning. I am Pastor Joseph Sheeran. I have the privilege and pleasure of welcoming all of you and leading you in this worship service, this hybrid format worship service on this Sunday morning. It's good to be with you all here in this. This natural light is really lovely. I'm glad we decided to go with this. If you are here for the first time or first time in a long time, we're glad you're here. We hope that you are feeling that welcome, feeling that love, and we hope that you feel invited and comfortable, and you can trust that participating in this service, as much or as little as feels right to you, is going to be very welcome. Along those lines, we will be celebrating communion today, as we do every Sunday here at Woodland Park Presbyterian Church. For those of you joining us remotely, it's great to see your faces and names on the screen. This is your invitation and reminder to have something ready to eat and drink when we get to that part of the service so that you can join us in this meal. And before we continue in worship, I want to share one final announcement that's very important to this congregation. I'd like to announce and acknowledge that Woodland Park Presbyterian Church and many of our homes are located on the unceded lands of the Duwamish people and other Coast Salish peoples. We acknowledge that they are still here, continuing to honor and bring light to their heritage, and we benefit every day from the theft of their land. And with those words of acknowledgement and hope that they may trouble us into action and relationship, let's continue in worship, sharing signs of peace that also spur us into action and relationship. Friends, one of our traditions born out of this time of pandemic is using the ASL for peace be with you. Peace be with you. Whether we're using the ASL for peace be with you, shaking hands, hugs, flashing peace signs, friends, the peace of Christ be with you all. Let's change those signs of peace.
Christ be with you. Christ be with you, Roger. Christ be with you, Judy. Eddie. Neola.
Christ be with you, Neola.
Recovery to Judy.
Thank you. I've tested negative for COVID, so as long as I don't get the rebound with Paxlovid.
People will come from east and west, from north and south, and will eat in the kingdom of God. Indeed, some are last who will be first, and some are first who will be last. We serve a God who hears the cries of those who hunger. We worship a God who comes from heaven to save. Come, as one people, let us worship together.
Seated.
Join me in the prayer of confession. Holy One, you sing to us a song of love, where the circle grows ever wider. Each time you have revealed yourself to us, your grace and love reaches out further and further, redeeming us from suffering, and calling us to be creatures of justice. To join in a song of unity and joy, to dance in your delight. Forgive us, Holy One, when we step too cautiously, when we fail to follow in your way, allowing injustice to take root, and dancing to the tune of doctrines that are contrary to the grace of your Son, Jesus Christ. Dance with us anew, Holy One. Correct our steps to match your song of love. Amen.
Friends, hear the good news. The God who created this world with a word is not finished speaking. The Christ who lived among us to redeem this world is still alive. And the Spirit who moved among and in the people of God is still moving. So where does that leave us? Who are we?
We are God's beloved and claimed in love. We begin again. Thanks be to God. Join me in the prayer for illumination. Redeeming God, as we gather to remember your saving purposes for all who are oppressed, give us minds, hearts, and wills to hear your word to us and then to live it. Amen. So our reading today is from Genesis 1, 1 through 5, and Revelations 21, 1 through 17, 1 through 7, sorry. When God began to create the heavens and the earth was in complete chaos, and darkness covered the face of the deep, while a wind from God swept over the face of the waters. Then God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw that the light was good, and God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "See, the home of God is among mortals. He will dwell with them. They will be his peoples. And God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more, for the first things have passed away." And the one who was seated on the throne said, "See, I am making all things new." Also he said, "Write this, for these words are trustworthy and true." Then he said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give water as a gift from the spring of the water of life. Those who conquer will inherit these things, and I will be their God, and they will be my children." The words of God for the people of God.
Today, we begin a new arc within our summer series. From Barman to Belhar, why we reject Christian nationalism. For the next 8 weeks, we will study the Confession of Belhar, which was drafted in 1982 by the Dutch Reformed Mission Church of South Africa. We'll do this study here and in community with our neighbors, Northminster Presbyterian Church and Wallingford Presbyterian Church. In fact, we will worship with our neighbors on three Sundays. Next Sunday, we will be gathered together, three churches in one place, over at the building that Northminster ordinarily worships in. On August 4th, we will be gathered again, three churches in one building, worshiping together in the building that Wallingford Presbyterian Church ordinarily worships in. And on August 8th, we will gather three churches in one place, in this building, in which Woodland Park Presbyterian Church ordinarily worships. We will also have one joyful interlude where this congregation will worship in Woodland Park as part of our picnic Sunday. That'll be on the 11th of August. We do this with our neighbors. We do this as a community of Presbyterian churches because the story of Belhar is a story of unity. It's a story of community. It's a story of Reformed churches around the world gathering together to state what they believe. Let's hear and read this first article of the Confession of Belhar. We believe in the triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, who gathers, protects, and cares for the church through word and spirit. This God has done since the beginning of the world and will do to the end. Will you all pray with me? Holy One, Holy One who cares for the church from the beginning until the end, send your spirit to us now. Send your spirit to move through this room, to move into and out of our lungs. And may the words of my mouth, the meditations of all of our hearts, and the life that we live be words, meditations, and lives that honor you. Amen. What is the context of Belhar? It's worth backing up. Confession of Belhar. Confession. Jane, what's a confession? Saying you're sorry. Jane's great. She gave me exactly the answer I wanted, and I didn't even prep her. Saying you're sorry. When someone confesses, we imagine saying, I shouldn't have done that. Or we might imagine, perhaps, in an instance of police injustice, someone being battered into confessing an act that they didn't commit. Confession. I did this. This is not the confession we're talking about. We might imagine when we hear Confession of Belhar, Dutch South African Church apartheid, that what we are reading is a statement of apology, of repentance. We have participated in the system of apartheid, and for that we are sorry. We confess our sins and we seek God's reconciliation. You would only get half credit for that answer. The Confession of Belhar, it's a doctrine, it's a proclamation of God's love, a proclamation of who God is and what God's church is called to do and be and believe. The Confession of Belhar is a statement of what we believe as church, not an apology, but a confession of belief. The context of Belhar, the context of South African apartheid, is one of respect, in a certain kind of way, for God's diversity. I hope none of you imagined that apartheid was not without, I hope that none of you imagined that apartheid was without religious scaffolding. There is a theology to apartheid. It is grounded in a reading of scripture. It is grounded in a adoration for God and an articulation that God's creation is diverse, teeming with diversity. Diversity of trees, of places, of animals, birds of the sea, and yes, diversity of people. Apartheid theologians of the South African Dutch Reformed tradition articulated that God created a diverse world with many tongues and many peoples, and we should not trouble God's creation by mixing them. To respect God's creation, to respect that diversity, we should keep ourselves separate for the good of our people and for the good of those people and for the good of those people. Now, this gives a lie to the nature of South Africa. South Africa, a country formed by colonialism and slavery. I can't imagine that that sounds familiar to anyone here. But the legacy of Dutch traders setting up a trading point at Cape Good Hope for the East India Company to stop over and receive refurbished water supplies, food for their journey to what they called the East Indies. A country that imported slaves from Indonesia and Madagascar to work that trading post. A country that pushed out the African peoples who were native to that land far away from their centers. And when finally it came time for people to mingle through economic necessity, worked very hard to keep all these peoples separate. This is a bit of a simplified version of South African history. I hope that you do take some time over the next month and a half to read into it. A story of colonialism, story of racism, story of separateness. This doctrine of apartheid that claimed itself to be a respect for diversity stood on a reading of Genesis, stood on a reading of how God created people, stood on a reading of the Tower of Babel. And yet it enacted not a respect for diversity, not a respect for different peoples, but domination. This is the nature of sin. This is the nature of human beings taking what God has created, which is that we are all people, that we are all diverse, that we are all different, and stating that it should remain that way in service of a few. And so when it was time for members of the Dutch Reformed Mission Church, which was not the white church, there were four different churches in South Africa for each of the racial groups created under the apartheid system: whites, coloreds, blacks, and Indians. The colored church, the Dutch Reformed Mission Church, began in the 1970s to begin to articulate a theological reason for what their movement had already begun to articulate, the injustice of apartheid, to articulate what God's anger, what God's problem with apartheid was, to be standing on religious language, to be standing in their tradition, fully grounded and reformed in their articulation of why God's vision, why God's kingdom does not look like apartheid. And in 1982, they created the Confession of Belhar. They began this confession, they began this statement with a citation of the book of Revelation that we just read. And they began with God. They didn't begin here because, as Julie Andrews might have sang, it's a very good place to start, the beginning, right? They began here because grounding their vision for their people, grounding the vision for their what is now called a rainbow nation, required going back to that foundation, required going back to that framework and addressing what was wrong with it. And so they wrote, "We believe in the triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, who gathers, protects, and cares for the church through word and spirit. This God has done since the beginning of the world and will do until the end." will do until the end. Their imagination of God's response to the moment that they found themselves in was rooted in their imagination of a God who is Alpha and Omega, who is beginning and end. We've had an interesting week, Woodland Park Presbyterian Church. We've had an interesting week, the United States of America. This week saw a burglary. This week saw a study on the practice of community organizing, the practice of listening and attending to story through one-on-one conversation. This week saw a marriage. This week saw two people join to a covenant of marriage that reflects God's diversity. The scripture that we heard yesterday came from the same book of Genesis, verse 26, the first half of the verse. Let us create human beings in our image. The nature of God in that story is plural and singular. God's nature is community. God's nature is relationship. And when we get married, we participate in that nature. We reflect that image of God in that particular way. When we gather as church, we reflect the image of God in that particular way. We become a plural and singular dynamic tension. And when we gather as a church to state what we believe, we reflect a plural and a singular at once in dynamic tension. This country is in a state of dynamic tension. As this election progresses, as our anxiety about this candidate or that candidate ebbs and wanes, as the questions about how it is that we will organize ourselves as a state hang over our lives and over our news media, former President Donald Trump was shot. I want to say this. It is okay to feel complicated feelings when a person who has encouraged and fomented and advocated for political violence suffers harm and survives an attempt on his life through political violence such as he might have advocated. If you feel complicated feelings about that, welcome. And yet, the vision of our country, the vision of our world that we are called to, the hope founded in Belhar, founded in Barman, founded in our scriptural witness to a God whose nature is diversity, to a God who creates the world, to a God who recreates the world, to an imagination of a life that is yet to come and is also becoming even in this very moment. To a God who has come to dwell among God's people, to share in their suffering, and yet we imagine God living with us even more fully in some future time. We are called to unity. We are called to reconciliation. Now, unity and reconciliation doesn't mean we tolerate and accept and just go with the flow and we just meet people where they are, wherever that may be. The Confession of Belhar stands as an example. The Dutch Reformed Mission Church, made up of people who were classified as colored under the apartheid system, people who were oppressed and marginalized and had their lives controlled by the state under the apartheid system, did not find it necessary to wait for the Dutch Reformed Church, that's the white church, to join them in this status, to join them in this confession. They have since merged with, I'm blanking on the name, they have since merged with the church that was for people called black under the apartheid system. They have since shared this confession with the World Alliance of Reformed Churches, of which the PCUSA is a member. And in this last decade, the PCUSA did pass. But the Confession of Belhar is a status that we ascribe to as well. It's a confession of what we believe as well. The Dutch Reformed Church of South Africa has never and has not affirmed, proclaimed, confessed with the Confession of Belhar. It is not incumbent on the Dutch Reformed Mission Church to meet them halfway. And the World Alliance of Reformed Churches did declare that the Confession of Belhar is status confessionis. It is what the Church believes and proclaims. And that did mean that the Dutch Reformed Church of South Africa is today excluded from the World Alliance of Reformed Churches, is marginalized. I encourage you to not feel too sorry for them in their marginalization, just as I encourage you to not feel too sorry for the apartheid government of South Africa prior to the end of apartheid. When we state what we believe, when we stand on who we are, when we do the work to imagine who God is and who God has created us to be, when we stand in that, we stand with God. Now we have to be humble. We have to always be imagining anew. We have to always begin again from the beginning. But we don't have to stand with everyone. And we don't have to stand for anything. In the midst of diversity, be who you are. Be a church that proclaims unity in God, that proclaims God's justice and liberation for all of God's children. Be a church that proclaims that God did not create us to be separate, but together. A church that proclaims God did not create us to be in hierarchy and opposition, but in community, seeking justice. Be a church and be a people here in this time and place who stand for something, who believe something, who proclaim something, who act, who discern, and with humility strive to walk with God. And God will delight when we are creators of justice. Amen.
Thank you.
As we live out the unity of the church here in this time and place, it's important to be in prayer. It's important to be in prayer because our lives are not lived as a series of theses and arguments. We are not a set of facts. We are creatures, feelings, living lives and events, holding relationship, holding fears, griefs, sorrows, and joy. Theology is not done with words, it's done with feelings. It's done with the substance of our lives, the substance of your hearts. And so when we gather to witness to who God is, it's important to pray together. It's important to reflect on what's happening in our lives together. It's important to witness and pray for what's happening in the world around us. So friends, as an expression of the body of Christ here in this place, what are the prayers of sorrow and concern among us today?
Our good friends, Guy and Pam, have a daughter, Courtney, and Courtney was put into the hospital this morning. She's about 31 weeks pregnant, and they're just trying so hard to keep her from delivering this baby until the lungs are, you know, fully developed. So prayers for Courtney and her husband, Craig, and their family.
For Courtney and Craig, and for their child, and for their family, I pray.
For Jake Heil and the loss of his instruments.
Jake Heil and the loss of his instruments.
For Jake Heil, who was hit especially hard by the burglary, the loss of his instruments, I pray. And for Scott Bale, who also lost several instruments in the burglary this week, I pray.
For Matt and his new wife that just got married yesterday.
For Matt and Dasha and a blessing on their marriage.
For Matt and Dasha and their marriage, I give thanks to God.
Hi there. I'm not sure if you know, but my dad, Dean Fournier, he has been having a tough time. He went into hospice status May 3rd. He's doing pretty well. He's getting good care as part of hospice. He's at home in an apartment with my mom, so that's good. He recently broke his hip, so he's had another little setback, and he's struggling, so just some prayers for him would be really appreciated.
For Dean and for his healing and peace, I pray.
So this is a tough one. I cannot think of one statement that Donald Trump has ever said that I've agreed with, ever. Nor everyone, pretty much everyone he surrounds himself with. But what happened to him yesterday was wrong, and I hope he gets well, and I'd pray for his family, because that's got to be a pretty fearful thing that they'll be dealing with. So that's all I'll say.
For former President Trump and for his family as they heal from the events yesterday, I pray.
So my prayer is for the perpetrators of our theft, our burglary, that they might find a different path in their lives that would take them away from this to I don't know, I just can't fathom someone feeling like they need to break into a church and steal things, but obviously they did, so I would pray that that their lives could be turned around and they can find a different path.
For those who broke into our church, for their healing and peace, I pray.
We're praying for the people in Nicaragua. It's a very dark time there right now. We work with one organization that takes food to children there, and they have 40 containers held up in customs, trying to get it through the government, and it's basically extortion. It's just a very, very difficult time. So we hold them up in prayer, especially the children of Nicaragua.
For the people of Nicaragua, for those who are waiting on this aid, this food that is being held up, and for those with power who are holding it up, that God's peace and abundance would move in that place, I pray.
Excuse me, I pray for our country and that when it comes to election, that we elect the person who, a person who is healthy, who can do the job, who not only can do the job, but is, will hold up the Constitution, and one that cares for all of us.
For this country, as it wrestles with this election, and for our leaders, that we would end this season of election with a president, with leaders who give us hope, who enact prudently, responsibly, and faithfully the work of serving this country. I pray. For the family of Pastor Jim Christensen in their grief, I pray. If there are not other prayers, let's continue in prayer. Holy One, we lift up to you these prayers, these notes of concern, sorrow, grief, and yes, one note of joy. Holy One, we lift up to you all those that don't yet find words to be spoken aloud. Our prayers for our neighbors, for families and friends who are living with grief, living with brokenness, for those who are suffering from isolation, mental health challenges, addiction, for those who are suffering from lack, who don't have all the things that they need, food, water, shelter, clothing, safety. God, we pray for all those with power, all those who are acting not for justice, but for power, all those who are acting not with grace, but seeking control. God, we pray for all the places in our world and in our lives, in this country, in this city, and everywhere, where your spirit is needed, where your peace is absent, where hope is waiting. God, we pray that your spirit would move in these places. And God, we thank you that you are not a distant God, not a far off God, but a God who came and lived a life like ours. That when we proclaim Christ, we proclaim you taking form and living among us,
sharing in our struggles, the ordinary rhythms of work and rest, and a God who knows grief, knows sorrow, knows heartbreak. And we thank you, God, not only for this presence with us in times of sorrow, but for moments of joy, for moments when the gospel moves us to stand on our feet and shout, and for moments of connection and celebration that give us a taste of your kingdom that is yet to come and is already breaking through into our lives. Friends, what are those prayers of joy and celebration? What are those moments where we feel the kingdom breaking through?
Prayers of joy for our grandnephew Richard, who would spend the last month helping us out and helping pretty much anybody that we knew, anything they needed. He's been proclaimed a mensch, and he's already planning to come back when Neil has his next surgery next month. So for Richard, we're
thankful. For Richard, I give thanks to God. Other prayers. We've already expressed gladness and celebration over the wedding of Matt and Dasha that happened here in this place yesterday. I'm going to repeat that. This was a really lovely ceremony. This was a lovely instance of the church gathered in worship and celebration of what God has done in their lives. And I just want to say that I am grateful for the ways that this church hosted that, for the way that the church lifted them up in prayer and celebration, and for the way that the church attended the party. And so with joy at the union of Matt and Dasha, and for the celebration, all their family and friends gathered here, and for this church being a part of that, I give thanks to God.
For Betty's being able to come with us to visit Nancy, with me and Alan, on Friday, and also to be able to attend the wedding, but also a prayer of concern and hope that she gets over her exhaustion and upset this morning from having had such a busy weekend.
For a visit in community with Nancy this weekend, I give thanks to God. And for Betty, for her recovery, for her gusto, her zest for life this weekend, even if it's kind of worn her out this morning, and all the ways that reflects her hard work on this journey to healing, I give thanks to God.
For the joy of 2 weeks of R&R on Whidbey Island, and the joy of, once again, it's been decades of having a little animal follow you all over.
For the joy of some time resting in a beautiful place and having a little animal friend following you around, I give thanks to God.
I'd like to give thanks for our upcoming 33rd anniversary. And that means we've been here at WPPC that long too.
When is it? For Keith and Margie's 33rd anniversary, which will be this Saturday, marking 33 years together and 33 years here at Wilden Park Presbyterian Church. For both of these things, I give thanks to God.
I marched in the Pride Parade, and I wasn't able to be here last Sunday, so this is what I would have said last Sunday. It was an amazing experience. I wasn't sure what it would be like to go and just march and sort of stare at people who are overjoyed that there is a bigger march, and to be sort of thinking about it strangely. You're excited because I'm here in the street. That's, I don't know what to do with that. But I brought a sign and I wore a t-shirt that said free dad hugs. And I gave so many hugs that I had to catch up a few times to the group I was walking with, because I need one now, I need one now. Everything from, I got one hug, it lasted 30 seconds. The person wouldn't let go. And almost I was a little awkward trying to, like, do I relax? Or, well, no, it's about them, so I'll let them. And then someone else ran up and said, I need a hug, and they told me because my dad kicked me out because of who I am. All kinds of things like that. It was just amazing being there with a group of Christians and kind of saying we were, but also we weren't there to convert anybody. We were just there to be God's love in that moment. And so it was amazing that we could do that and share in the pride moment of the day.
For the witness of Seattle Presbyterians, or as they styled themselves that day, Presbyquerians, there are stickers outside on the pink table. Proclaiming God's love and embrace of all of God's children, and especially on that day, God's queer children. And for Todd's unique and special experience of ministry that day, for the hugs, for the sign proclaiming Jesus' embrace of them, and for all of those who needed that moment of connection, that moment of healing, that moment of embrace, and for the gift of both providing and receiving that, Todd experienced that day, I give thanks to God for Todd's witness and ministry.
I was down in California to help my daughter. My granddaughter, Maggie, had successful tonsil and adenoid removal. And it wasn't easy when you're only three, but she did it, and she's gained almost a pound in a few weeks since that happened. So very grateful for that, because she's tiny. And also to spend time with my grandson, which I read lots of books while she got hugs from Mom. Mm-hmm.
Maggie and Joseph.
Yeah. For Maggie and for her healing, for the ways that she's already showing renewed strength after this, and for time with both Maggie and Jensen, I give thanks to God. Other prayers. If there are no more prayers of joy, and I know that all of you are living joy every day in your hearts, especially joy. It's so fun to get here sometimes. Let's continue in prayer with the words, in playfully, joyfully proclaiming that we are God's people, using the words that Christ taught us as printed in our bulletin. Our Creator in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. In a moment here, Jake Heil is going to be offering us yet another of his excellent musical prayers. And as you're meditating, as you're praying, as you're letting the words of the song, the melodies, the words that we prayed and said and studied earlier today wash over you, feeling the Spirit move, a plate is going to come by. Whether you're putting something into that plate or not, I want to invite you, I want to remind you to reach out and touch it, to hold it for a second. If you're joining us remotely, this is your reminder to reach out with your hands, reach out with your heart, use the raise hand button. And that's because each of us, all of us, you, with your gifts of yourself, with your gifts of your time, your talent, your treasures, you sustain what God is doing here in this place. And so as we have been given in many different ways, we give in many different ways. And let us give now. Amen.
You came into this world with eyes as clear as water. You didn't look a thing like your grandmother's daughter. With a heart so heavy and beating like a drum, yeah, neither did you look like your grandfather's son. And when everything changes, our love will stay the same. And when everything else goes away, our love will still remain. Wilder than a brush fire burns deep inside the bramble. Maybe I think God made our souls born to ramble. Maybe you'll take to the faraway places where life is gonna deal you a handful of aces. But it doesn't really matter how great the space is. Retrained. And when everything changes, our love will stay the same. Retrained. And when everything else goes away, our love will still remain. Life has a fuse and it burns with a quickness, but death ain't the long twisted branch of sickness. Just as the spark gives birth to a flame, we'll be bound by our love and in the family name.
With words, with music, with acts of service and prayer, we offer our gifts to you, Holy One. We pray that you would take these gifts, that you would take these givers, and that you would bless us all, that you would use us faithfully for the building up of your kingdom. May it be so. Amen. Amen. Part of sharing of our time and our talents, sharing of ourselves, is that when there are things happening in the church, when there are opportunities to connect and serve, we share them with each other. And so as Dave and Todd are already moving, I want to invite you, if you have an announcement, to move to the front of the church. Todd has found the microphone that I was looking for, thank goodness, and tell us what we need to know. Todd.
Tuesday evening is the third Tuesday, and that's Holy Hops, 6:30 at Poor Decisions. We'll gather and talk about a really cool question that's been brought up, and see where we wind up talking 2 hours later. So it's a good time, a good social time. So 6:30 Tuesday evening at Poor Decisions. And then the other thing is, as Pastor Joe talked about in his sermon, over the next 6 weeks, there's a different worship schedule, different churches, sometimes there, sometimes here, once at the park. It's always in the bulletin, so check that on Mondays when you get that and confirm. I think all the start times are the same, but the locations are going to be a little different. So just pay attention to that. We'll try to announce them as well on Sundays.
Yeah, the start times will all be the same. It's always going to be 10:30. When we are worshiping at Northminster and Wallingford, we'll be worshiping. It'll be on Zoom. It'll be their Zoom. We'll make sure to share that in the Monday bulletin the week ahead of that. So if you're worried about Zoom, be sure to check that out. If you're worried about a ride, be sure to reach out to office at WPPC Seattle or Joe at WPPCSeattle.org. There will be childcare at all three of these other locations. I think that's it. Yeah.
Cool.
10:30.
Can you, in the bulletin, talk about parking?
I can talk about parking right now. So both Northminster and Wallingford are like us. They are urban churches. They are neighborhood churches. So it is going to be a street parking situation. There is a limited amount of off-street parking at Wallingford. If you require that for accessibility reasons, let us know. We'll see if we can get that set aside for you. Northminster and Wallingford, both churches are pretty accessible. They have street level, so it's onto the sidewalk and into the church. There is not a parking lot. Yeah, but there's abundant. They're both more set off from the main drag than we are. So where we find ourselves competing with yoga and bench bread and the other things for parking, I think you'll have an easier time in those places. But do give yourself a little cushion for parking, for getting settled, for figuring out where you need to be. We're going to be in a new place. For Woodland Park on August 11th at the picnic, I am not the person to speak to parking there.
There's parking there, so that'll work. And if I can take three people in my car, so whoever calls first, the first three can get a seat. I can do an Uber and pick everybody up. But give me a call if you want to carpool.
The Property with Purpose team, we're going to be meeting right after church today. I'm thinking it's going to be a short meeting because at least one of us wants to rush home to see a big time soccer match. So stay tuned.
If there are not more announcements, let's continue in worship. Now today we're going to be trying something brand new. Each of you has in front of you in the seat back a white piece of paper. on the front, the sheet with just one set of words, is our new communion song. J. Kyle has set the words for communion, similar to what we've done in the past, to the tune of For Everyone Born. On the back side here, you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 verses to For Everyone Born. Now, we may in the future add some additional verses. I understand that there are quite a lot of verses flowing out there. But for today, what we're going to do is we're going to sing this new communion song and verse 1 of For Everyone Born and the chorus of For Everyone Born. Now, perhaps, J. Kyle, this might be a good time to sort of teach this song.
We know this song.
We know this song? We know this song. Okay. Well, since we know this song, let us begin. We gather at this table because Jesus said, "Do this in remembrance of me." The Lord be with you.
God be with you also.
Lift up your hearts, we lift them to God. Let us give thanks to God our Creator.
It is right that we give
our thanks and our praise. We gather at this table because Jesus said, "Do this in remembrance of me." This table is more than the table of Woodland Park Presbyterian Church, but this table is set by Jesus Christ for the whole world. And Christ has called us here to be bread for the world. Now, following after the work of Christ is not easy. When we seek to be bread for the world, we are called to discern Christ's way on difficult questions. God, you call us to find ways to live united with all your church, to serve your people, to act for justice with mercy and love, even in the midst of division. When we gather at this table, and when we are in turn sent to be bread for the world, we are bound up in something so much greater than ourselves, greater than this congregation, greater than our imagination. Holy Three in One, whose nature is relationship, you formed the world, the mountains and the waters, the trees and the stars, and us in your image. Here at your table, we invite your spirit to fall afresh upon us. Relieve us of our fears, our prejudices, and our limited imaginations. Sharpen our ears and our hearts to listen more as you do. And with this simple meal, cleanse us and renew us of the sins of the world, and renew us for witness to your love and to your grace, to be your hands and feet of you, O Ancient One, whose glory rings through the whole world, and yet whose greatest glory is grace and love for all of us. And so, united with the church in every time and place, we sing together in witness and awe. Holy, holy, great God Almighty, heaven and earth are full of your grace. Hosanna, we sing, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in your name. Friends, we gather at this table because Jesus said, "Do this in remembrance of me." When we do this, this table is more than the table of Woodland Park Presbyterian Church. It is set by Christ and is open for all who seek to love and follow Jesus. In Jesus' name, we welcome you, all of you, no matter where you have been or what you may have done, no matter what your church experience may or may not be, no matter what you may fear, no matter what you doubt, how you've been hurt or how you've hurt. If you seek Jesus, the living bread, this meal is for you. Let us sing together. For everyone born,
a place at the table for everyone born clean water and bread, a shelter of space, a safe place for growing for everyone born a star overhead. And God will delight, we are creators of justice and joy, compassion and peace. Yes, God will delight when we are creators of justice and joy.
Praise to you, O God, for all your works. You created the world and you called it good. You made us in your image to live together in love. You made a covenant with us, and even when we turned from you, you remain always faithful, always calling us back. We thank you for sending us Jesus, who lived among us, told your story, showed your mercy, healed the sick, and welcomed sinners. We thank you that Jesus emptied himself for us, shared our pain, died our death, and rose to new life, that we might live and all creation be restored. Gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these gifts, that the bread we break and the cup we bless may be the communion of the body and blood of Christ. By your Spirit, unite us with the living Christ and with all your church, that we may be one in ministry in every place. As this bread is Christ's body for us, send us to be the body of Christ in the world. Scripture tells us that on the night Jesus was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "This is my body for you. Take, eat. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after they had eaten, Jesus took the cup and saying, "This cup is the new covenant, sealed in my blood. When you drink it, remember me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again." Friends, you are the body of Christ. Take and eat. Amen. Thank you. friends, we follow a God who is beyond our imagination, whose faithfulness is greater than ours, whose mercies are new every morning, and whose love for each of you and for each of our neighbors is transcendent. And so trusting in this love, trusting in this faithfulness, trusting in this gospel that we have, go and tell those neighbors, go and tell the world, tell them who you are, tell them who God is, tell them about love, that you're trying, that you're growing. Listen, love, and connect. And maybe, just maybe, you could sometimes use words. But in this way, go and discover and serve a God whose love is great, whose faithfulness is new every morning. Follow in this way. And as you go, may the grace of God, the love of Jesus Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all this day and every day. Amen.
Do our Mevo cameras have sound capabilities?
Yeah.